Yep. Greetings, everyone. This is Michael King, and welcome back to B-Movie Mania, celebrating the films of the legendary B-Movie King himself, Roger Corman. Now, if you guys will recall the last episode of B-Movie Mania, I took a look at a film called The Terror Within. And on that same DVD, there's another film entitled Dead Space. Now, Dead Space bears no resemblance to the Electronic Arts game Dead Space or Dead Space 2. And it's really one of those obscure Corman films that got little to no playtime on television. And it really wasn't seen a whole lot on the cable channels either. But the film does exist, and fortunately, this weekend, I was able to spare the time and take a look at the movie, Dead Space. Now, guys and gals, Dead Space was directed by a young man named Fred Gallo. Now, Fred Gallo was 24 years old when he got the job to direct this film. He was paid a measly $5,000, but it was all well and dandy for him because he had just graduated from college with a master's degree, and he was ready and hungry to direct a film. Now, Roger Corman saw his thesis film and liked what he saw and invited Gallo to his studio. Now, once he got there, Corman said, "Hey, I saw your thesis film and I very much liked it, and I would like you to direct a film that we are making if you're interested." And, of course, Gallo was interested, more than interested. As a matter of fact, he's even stated that being fresh out of college, he'd have directed this film for nothing. And pretty much that's what he was getting. But anyway, Corman wanted him to direct the film, and he agreed. Now, Gallo's first question to Corman was, "Where's the script?" And Corman said, "Come back in a week when we start filming, and you'll have the script." So, true to his word, Gallo returned in a week, and Corman had provided the script to the film. Now, guys and girls, unfortunately, there's a very limited amount of information on the making of this film, and what's provided, as far as the disc is concerned, is totally in the memories of director Fred Gallo. Now, we do know that Dead Space had a 17-day shooting schedule. The budget was next to none, even for a Corman film. And some of the sets used for an earlier Corman film entitled Forbidden World were used in this movie. And as a matter of fact, to go even further, there was an actual connection between Forbidden World and Dead Space. Now, Dead Space could be called a remake of a remake of a remake. Meaning that Forbidden World was made as a remake to Alien, and Dead Space was made as a remake for Alien and Forbidden World. I'm getting confused. But anyway, not only did this film use sets from Forbidden World, but it also had a script that was based heavily on the film Forbidden World. That's where you have several events in that film occur in this film. And basically, this film is so close to the events that happen in Forbidden World, it's almost the same film, with the exception of the actors and some of the sets. Now, some of the sets were put together in Venice, and they're not as cheaply made as some of the sets in Forbidden World, where you have McDonald's styrofoam boxes decorating the hallways of the scientific lab. But you actually have a pretty decent looking lab in this. And to hide some of the shoddy construction on the sets, Corman and the rest of the staff used a heavy amount of smoke to cover some of these errors in the film, where the sets just didn't look good at all. Now, guys, there was also other cost-saving attributes that Roger Corman placed on the set of the film, and one of those were that, given that there was such a large cast of actors in this film, he said that no one could work over 8 hours. No overtime. And given the strict rules of the SAG actors, he got around paying them overtime by dismissing the actors when their time was up. So when you see scenes in the film where all the actors are seated together or interacting together, oftentimes those actors were filmed separately. And Corman used people offset or production people to read the lines of the actors so that they weren't paid overtime. And a lot of the actors didn't like this fact. They didn't like working with production staff or people that didn't have anything to do with the scenes being filmed. And they voiced their opinion. But that's how it is in a Corman film. You have to bring it in on schedule and on time. Another interesting tidbit about the film is that the monster used in the movie was an articulated puppet. A massive puppet, as a matter of fact. And that came about because Corman and the director had agreed that they were just extremely tired of the man in the monster suit. They wanted something a little bit more convincing. So the monster was designed and created, but unfortunately, in many of the shots, it lacked the articulation to make it believable. But at other times, it came across as just okay. And you'd have to see the film, but some of the film, the monster is featured just as if he's on some kind of wheels, on a dolly wheel, and just running across the scenes. And in one scene in particular, it burst through one of the science station doors, and you can tell that someone's just pushing it. As a matter of fact, if you look closely, you can actually see where the monster is separated by the dolly and the wheels and like waist below, and it just looks totally unconvincing. It goes by fast, but if you got a sharp eye, you can see it. In typical Corman fashion, guys, being that Fred Gallo was a new director, a young director, he kept a close eye on the production of the film, and that included showing up on the set several times. And in one incident, he showed up and he took a look at the script, and he didn't like what he was reading, and he actually tore the pages out of the script and said, "This is not going to be filmed. This material is unnecessary for the story, and we've got to cut costs." So, you know, those scenes were just ejected from the story. And Corman was right. He'd been in the business for years and years. And let's face it, guys, if anybody could make a low-budget B film, it's Roger Corman. So, you know, and Fred Gallo was a new director, and he took heed to Corman's warning. And after this meeting, they went back to the studio. Corman called the director and the editor into his office, and Corman had his assistant there, and his assistant was more or less telling the director and the editor what and what not they didn't want in the film. And Gallo's editor made the mistake of not writing one note down of what Corman and the assistant was saying. And Roger Corman got annoyed. He stood up and he looked at Gallo and he said, "Who is this guy?" And Gallo said, "This is the editor of the film." Corman reached out his hand and said, "It's nice to meet you. Now you're dismissed." So the editor walked out, and Corman turned to his assistant and he said, "Fire that guy immediately." So Corman got kind of annoyed that the guy didn't pay him any attention as far as what he was saying about the film and what he wanted about the film. And that's just an example of Roger Corman. He had a strong, steady hand on his studio, and where he wanted a film to go, that's where it was going to go. So yeah, guys, you know, and another thing about the film is that as far as this transfer is concerned, it's not as good as the other Roger Corman Shout Factory transfers to DVD have been. I mean, it's not altogether bad, but it's definitely not as beautiful and pristine as some of the other copies of Roger Corman's films. This one is quite grainy. It looks a little bit washed out at times. And in low light scenes, it's really, really grainy. But like I said, I would kind of rank it right up there with probably a little bit better than a new VHS copy. But other than that, I mean, it's definitely watchable. And a lot of you maybe fans of Mark Singer. And you might be curious about his performance in the film, how he tackled the role, what I thought about it. I really like Mark Singer as an actor. I enjoyed him immensely since I saw him in The Beastmaster, and then, of course, on television in the original V science fiction series. Now, in this film, Mark Singer does seem to be kind of like a fish out of water. I would even say that he kind of hams it up a little bit. He's really, really emotive in this. He's expressive to the point of just being hammy. There are times in this movie when Mark Singer will spout out dialogue and he'll have his hand on his hips and he'll be shaking his head, and it just comes across as really hammy and kind of juvenile the way he acts in this film. Now, that's not to say that he's like this throughout the entire film, because he isn't. But in some situations, you can't help but look at the acting and the body language and all and kind of cringe, like, oh my God. But other than that, Singer's okay in the film. So overall, guys, Singer is pretty good in the film. He's definitely not as good as the actor who he mirrors from the film Forbidden World. But overall, he's a decent actor in the film, but definitely not his best performance and not his best role. And speaking of Forbidden World, guys, I've mentioned it just a little bit before, but this film is a mirror copy of Forbidden World. And a lot of that is due to the fact that the script for this film was taken from Forbidden World. It was taken from Forbidden World and reworked. A few changes here, a few changes there. But overall, it is a very thinly disguised remake. I mean, you have the same stock footage. Not the same stock footage, but you have stock footage from Battle Beyond the Stars opening up the film. You have Mark Singer resting or sleeping in a chamber, just like the opening from Forbidden World. You have a robot piloting the ship. The ship gets attacked, just like it was in Forbidden World, and Mark Singer rushes up to the bridge. There's this unnecessary laser battle with these ships that you don't know what the hell they're fighting him for. You don't know what the hell they are to him, but Mark Singer goes through the motions of a space battle here, and nothing else is said about it. You know, you don't hear him give any kind of explanation as to why these people are attacking him. And I had the same criticism for Forbidden World. You have this opening scene that kind of just serves to show off the stock footage from Battle Beyond the Stars. And that's all this does. It just shows off stock footage without a purpose. And, you know, the similarities go on and on. Not only is this film similar to Alien, but it is almost a mirror of Forbidden World. Even down to the women, you know. In Forbidden World, we had the bounty hunter come aboard the science station. He's immediately seduced by one of the beautiful women. In this, Mark Singer comes aboard the station and is seduced by one of the girls. And I mean, the sex is nowhere near the level that was in Forbidden World. There's, you maybe see just a little bit of breasts in this, nipples, but nowhere near the level of Forbidden World. It appears Roger Corman was getting a little bit soft in his later life. But that's not to say that the women in this film aren't beautiful as well, because there are some really nice looking women in the film. Even the way the creature is destroyed from Forbidden World is copied in this film. And of course, I don't want to give that away, because you may not have seen either film, but just the entire screenplay in Forbidden World. The bounty hunter went outside to search for the creature who escaped outside. And in this film, Mark Singer and his robot have to go outside as the creature has escaped outside. And the location is the same. They're both filmed at the Vasquez Rocks. So, I mean, it's just amazing how similar this film is. And you got to ask yourself, if you're going to make a film that is just a mirror image of another film, why in the freak make it? I don't understand Corman's motivations in this film, and sadly, there's no response or any information given from Roger Corman about the making of this film, so we don't know why he chose this particular script. And even the director who made the film wasn't aware of the connection with Forbidden World. He'd never seen the film, but years later, he mentions that, yeah, he had heard that it was similar to Forbidden World, but he kind of chalked it up as, you know, we had enough changes in our film to make it different. But that is definitely not the case. Now, if you've seen Forbidden World, you remember the scene where the bounty hunter and one of the scientists were outside, and the creature jumps into this vent and goes underground. And then one of the scientists looks over into the vent, and the creature just snatches him up and pulls him down the vent. Exact same scene in Dead Space. It's just amazing. Now, all I can say that's really kind of positive about Dead Space is that it's more of a sanitized version of Forbidden World. It's a better made film. It looks cleaner. It looks a little bit more focused and not as kind of gritty. And just like Forbidden World had this kind of thrown together look to it. Well, this film looks like it was put together well. But unfortunately, the things that made Forbidden World more popular than this film are definitely missing from this film. And that goes for the gratuitous nudity, the gore. I mean, you have a little bit of gore here. But even the creatures themselves, which gestate inside a live living host, if that's a surprise to you guys. But even the creature itself generates very little terror. And this film is real hit and miss. And mainly, the problem with this film is that it tries too damn hard to be like Forbidden World. So with that said, guys, I can't say that it's definitely one of Roger Corman's best outings. I watched the film. I enjoyed it on a level of like, oh my God, this is just like Forbidden World. What are they thinking? Why are they doing this? Why are they making this movie? Make something original. It's a thinly veiled, disguised film that if you've seen Forbidden World, most likely you're not going to get too much enjoyment out of this one. This one's just a mediocre Corman film. Definitely not his worst and definitely not his best, but it's definitely borderline in between. But for those people who've never seen too many Corman films, it could be considered a rare treat, I suppose. Just, you know, I enjoyed watching it just for the sake of never having seen it before. But overall, I wouldn't recommend it. I mean, I'm a B-movie fan, and I just thought the film was okay. But I'm glad to have it in my collection. And another thing about this film is a theatrical poster. Now, what is this supposed to have in relation to the film? Absolutely nothing. I don't understand why that's on there. I mean, look at the terror within. At least you have the creature that terrorized them in that movie. But in this movie, you have a guy floating around in space as a skeleton, which has absolutely nothing to do with this movie. But anyway, guys, thanks for watching. And next time on my focus of the Roger Corman films, I have a film that is probably going to shock you all, that you never even seen, that I never even heard of. And I came across it accidentally. What is it? You'll just have to wait and see. Thanks for watching, everybody. Take care, and I'll see you at the next B-Movie Mania, the films of the legendary Roger Corman. Thanks for watching, everybody. It's hot. Take care.